The Late Night Legends podcast is meant for an adult audience only. It may contain sexually oriented content. Content may not be suitable for sensitive listeners. Please be aware of your surroundings. Listener discretion is advised.
Beckoning voices and spinning, you have no choice.
Host Kay. I'm here with Jesse, Joan, and we have a very special guest tonight that we're really excited about. This is Stormphrog.
Hello, everybody.
He's been on a couple times.
Yeah. About him being a guest, we will come back to that. Let's just do some announcements first. Tonight's episode is going to be about haunted art. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yep. And just so you know, some upcoming announcements. On the 8th, we're going to have Jesse's topic, which is the Sierra Sounds. And then on the 15th, James will be returning with us, and I believe he's going to do Atlantis. And then on the 22nd, we had planned to do wedding superstitions because Frank is getting married, but maybe that will change. We will have to discuss that as a group. Speaking of Frank and just getting this out of the way, elephant in the room, clearly someone is missing today, and that would be Frank. And on behalf of us here at Late Night Legends, I have to read this verbatim. So, due to legal reasons, we are not at liberty at this time to disclose the reason for Frank not being with us and being let go from the Late Legends, but I can assure you we will be fighting for our right to keep this show as well as presenting our likeness from here on out. It was for reasons, as I said, we can't really explain, but they do get quite personal. So that being said, we would like to introduce Stormphrog onto our podcast, who at this time will be replacing Frank. So we have been talking about this in the background for a while now, and that's actually why Stormphrog has a show for us today. So we really appreciate it. As I mentioned before, thank you for coming on last minute. I know this has been in the works, but I don't think you expected to come on tonight to do this.
No. Circumstances being what they are, sometimes you just have to step up, you know. And I consider you guys very much my friends, you know. I've been friends not just with Frank, but with those I've met as Late Night Legends has grown, when it's gone from Super Balls to Late Night to Late Night Legends and where we are now. So just doing my best to, you know, keep things going, keep things flowing.
Yeah, we're really happy to have you here. I mean, we can't give any details, but it's about dead time, just saying.
Yeah, it's understandable considering everything.
Yeah, I mean, like, it sucks after Women's History Month, especially, but that's all I'm at liberty to say right now. But in brighter news, we, as Late Night Legends podcast, have reached 1,000 subscribers on YouTube. So we really appreciate that. thank you for everyone who's tuning in or who's going to be able to watch this later. We hope that we keep growing bigger and better. And you can follow us over at Late Night Legends on YouTube. We also have a TikTok where we post quite often. And you can follow us once again live on Twitch like we do every Monday night. So that being said, do we have any other announcements? Jesse, did I see something on Facebook? Do you want to say anything about that with your vendor? No?
Oh, well, it's the last one I'm doing this year. It's just the poster came out, so I got excited. What is it? June, Friday the 13th. September, Friday the 13th until the 16th. I'm going to be vending at the Great Lakes Paranormal Conference up in, I think it's in Glenbula, Wisconsin. I'll have to learn how to pronounce that. I'll be doing the Reiki and sound healing there. Dave Schrader's going to be there. Chad Lindbergh, Cindy Kaza, the Expedition Bigfoot crew. It's going to be a lot of people there. It's going to be a lot of fun. I can't wait for September. So I guess that's the really newer thing.
Yeah. That's really exciting. I'm looking over at the chat. I wish I could say that now, right, guys? I really wish I could say that right now, but I can't say that right now. So that being said, let's get into this topic. So Stormfrag, take it away.
Yeah, so as mentioned before, and as very briefly touched upon in a couple of streams back, it was mentioned at some point we would be covering the paranormal and the world of art and the correlation between the creator and the possibility of not just, you know, bringing a canvas to life, but the possibility of really bringing a canvas to life. And we actually have quite a few subjects to discuss on the matter. I know somebody out there is probably already thinking he's going to discuss the crying boy. He's going to discuss, the hands resist him, which we will be getting into. Those are two very famous haunted photos, or rather works of art. Both very, very unsettling, but I have a couple of more to get into. And then I think it would be best to end with perhaps one of the biggest paranormal mysteries, if you want to view it from that angle, featuring a very famous painter. Most of y'all have probably seen his work, Francisco Goya. He's the one who painted most infamously Saturn consuming his own child.
Which I have that for you, if that's what you would like to have on the screen.
As a matter of fact, yeah, let's show them. So this right here, it in some way, shape, or form, you're probably familiar with this painting. It's used in a lot of popular media. I know some people have been posting it on TikTok with all these different theories and such behind it. And it's because we really don't know much about this painting, but there is this very strong belief that, you know, not only is this an unsettling painting, but it was also painted by a very unsettled artist. And without going too deep into detail, Francisco Goya, toward the end of his life, he was a very prominent and very well-known painter. He was commissioned quite thoroughly throughout his life. Again, he made it as big of a celebrity of a painter as you could be during that day and age. But toward the end of his life, he became a recluse. He, you know, sequestered himself in his country home. He started going deaf, and that played into a very negative impact on his life. A lot of people, those closest to him, said that he was, you know, getting a little more depressed as he aged. And some people theorized he may have been developing a kind of either paranoia or something spawned from these new ailments he was developing as he was getting older. But where this painting comes into play is that after he passed away, for months, nobody went into his house, his last abode. And when they did finally go in there, inside of his house, all over the walls, were these oil paintings. And they weren't preserved in any way, shape, or form. They were just scrawled on them. And it wasn't like, I'm going to cut this section of the wall. I'm going to make this real pretty. No, this was thick layers of black, dark grays, very, very morose paintings. And this one right here that we're looking at, Saturn devouring his child, it plays off of the Greek, I guess you could say the Greek legend of, of Saturn, or Saturn, Zeus rather, devouring his children. And he's painted it very unnervingly. A lot of people say it's the eyes that disturb people the most, that this is the painting that embodied the madness that he was starting to succumb to. And this is just one of the many paintings that he did that people claim he poured his insanity into. There are others as well. If you do want to look deeper into Francisco Goya and what is known as the Pinturas Negras, which translates to the Black Paintings, which is the series of different paintings that were found inside his house. He's even done alternates of ones that were committed, that were commissioned for churches. So there's one that shows a pilgrimage of all these very happy, joyous people. You know, they're rejoicing. There's this long procession. They're playing instruments. Everyone is smiling. He has a stark contrast painting that he did of that. Everyone is in their exact same position, but their expressions are different. All of a sudden, they're mourning. All of a sudden, they look as though they were in these throes of desperation, where there was once blue clouds and sun, it is now storm clouds and it is dark. Everyone's wearing black, and it's just a very unsettling image. And people do believe it is a theory that, again, it was his madness that painted this, but not Goya himself. You know, so this kind of raises the question, are these very unsettling pictures, are they just unsettling because they're dark? Or is there something more to this? Is there a negativity that may have been trapped within the medium that he used? Are these thick, dark oils somehow manifesting this energy, this residual angst and sadness and whatnot, long after he had passed away? And these paintings only survive today because I believe it was his son and a couple of others who, you know, were like, well, what do we do with this estate? Went in there. They had somebody try and restore it as best they could. They cut out the sections of wall. And you can still go and see these things in different museums to this day. Might want to, you know, bring some protective beads of your choice when you go to hang out around these things. But yeah, that is the first one I definitely wanted to open up with, because Francisco Goya, as a painter myself, as an artist myself, I love his shadow work. There's so much I love about his work, but you can definitely tell there's a difference. There's something that's just, it's almost, if I could describe it, animalistic, especially the eyes. And you got to remember, this is a restoration of what the original was. It's said that when they first discovered these were very, very lifelike. It's almost as if these were actual demons that you could say were trapped within the walls of this house that, again, he spent months, you know, just cloistered and surrounded by this day and night. And if, in fact, paintings could be haunted, if you could take away something paranormal and instill it into some kind of image, you best believe the paintings, the Pinturas Negras, I believe that is the epitome of a haunted painting.
You know how sometimes you can have like a good energy in the room and somebody will walk into the room and you can just feel the whole energy change?
Yes.
I wonder if it's something similar to that, where there is so much negative energy focused into this painting while he was painting it, that it's a little bit similar, that he just infused all of this energy into the painting itself.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I know that there are some articles you can find where they documented the last few years of his life, and there's some journal entries of one of the men who had actually gone into the house when they discovered these, who just talks about how there was a very deathly stillness, that as soon as you crossed the threshold, it almost felt like you had stepped out of the living world and entered like the realm of the dead. Because again, you're surrounded on all sides of these images, things that are deathly, things that are unholy. And you know, Francisco Goya was a very religious man in his life. To see him turn to this toward the end, I'm sure it was very shocking. It had to have definitely affected people, like a, you know, like a punch in the gut the moment you entered the home of this man who was very much celebrated and, you know, for lack of a better word, enjoyed his life and his work.
So I don't know a lot about this person, but do we have any information on where this inspiration was coming? Was he having night terrors?
From what little is known, because again, he kind of just disappeared from the public eye toward the end of his life. we do know he was going deaf. We also know that during the time, toward the end of his life, he had seen, I believe it was like the Spanish Civil War during the time. He had seen a lot of warfare. And seeing that over, you know, a lifetime of all these struggles, of all this death, of all this sadness, even if you're well off, even if you are this famous painter, even if you're a celebrity, I can only imagine at some point and you just sit there with this, coupled with, you know, you're ailing, coupled with you're going deaf, your senses are being cut off. And with him being an artist, one, he's visually capturing everything he's seen, all that war, all that death is being, you know, it's captured in his mind. Because those who are very creative thrive on the senses, what they, you know, what they see, what they feel, what they hear. To have one of those senses, if not a handful of them, taken away, I'm sure he really wasn't even himself toward the end. So he just did what he did best. He coped by doing what he knew how to do, and that was paint.
So something that might be interesting, I don't know if it goes along with this necessarily, but also the choice of medium. Mm-hmm. Oil paint is very corrosive. So it takes a lot to restore them. And when you do it, you need a lot of lacquer or a lot of prep on your canvas. So just painting it on a wall means that the wall was being eaten away while doing this, which is also interesting with the deterioration idea. But also based on the year, I can also probably assume there was a lot of lead in that oil paint. Just painting with lead and that idea of deteriorating and going further and further. And we know now that lead poisoning causes the deterioration of the mind. So not saying it's a cause, but it might have helped along the way with the disturbing images.
That's very, very possible. And in fact, I'm glad you brought that up, because this is a bit of a wild assumption. But because this is a paranormal, you know, podcast, I'll go ahead and throw it out there, because I'm totally on board with this theory. In a very strange way, Francisco Goya, they don't know if this is intentional. Again, take this with a grain of salt. When you paint on a canvas with oil, you prepare it. You know, it's very meticulous what you need. And then as you're painting it, there's certain things you have to add in. You need chemicals of various spirit. You have to use various spirits, rather, I'll say, to help preserve the painting. I mean, there are paintings that still aren't dry even 80 years later, if you can believe that. That's 100% true. They believe that he didn't do any of that because he intended these paintings to decay with him. So as he decayed, as he would not be long for this world, he quote-unquote gave birth to these just to watch them decay along with him. And after he passed, so too would they corrode and rot away. Mm-hmm. And it was almost like his magnum opus, if you will, but it would go along with him into this next world.
Yeah. And just speaking, what has always spoke to me about this painting with the look in the eye is not only, it's it's almost like regrettable animalistic behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Like the upward turned eyebrow seems like almost frightened about the violent actions that's being taken.
Oh, absolutely.
And I thought this also came about with something to do with the loss of a family member as well, but that might be a different artist that I'm thinking of. But like, it's a lot of violence in this series of paintings.
Yeah, because I mean, he lived quite a while. He lived to a good old age, but even so, chances are there were some loss of family members in there. I mean, everybody, once you live long enough, you do see loved ones, you know, regrettably pass as time goes on. So definitely that could have contributed. It could have been some inspiration within this. I mean, Goya himself may have imagined himself as Saturn and his work being the thing that is being devoured. There's a lot of theories behind it, and that just kind of opens up a wider perspective on a paranormal sense to these paintings. And nobody, as far as I've read, have said that, oh, this is 100% this is haunted, but it is everything surrounding it. It's their discovery, it's their preservation, it's even in their creation that's just, it hits a very memorable and spooky note with the viewer.
It does, and especially with this, because most people or most artists would probably say they want to create a legacy within their paintings, but him literally giving it life in the way that he also gave it a time of decay and deterioration and death is very odd, but interesting, and goes along with that idea of like literally breathing life into it in that way.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, that was just one of the first paintings. Definitely one of the ones that we would be diving more deeper into. So I guess it's good that we did start with that one, because the following paintings, nothing really goes into that much detail.
Sorry I'm late, guys. For some reason, I couldn't log in. Like, all my passwords were different. So yeah, I'm here now. I got everything to work somehow. Had to do some recovery. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Why is there a click clack?
What?
Oh, it's gone. There was a click clack noise. What'd you do?
Oh. Hi, Frank.
Hi. I don't know about no click clack noise.
I thought we talked about this, but hi. I guess you can stay.
Okay. Cool.
Okay.
What are we talking about? How we doing? Got some Saturn going on here?
Yes. Yeah.
Nice.
Spooky paintings.
Yeah.
We know, Stormfrog, we know your first name starts with a J, because in your Google account there in the corner it says J.
Well, this is my account, so.
Oh, shit. Well, I'm stupid. Yeah. All right, well, never mind me.
If you came to any of the team meetings, you would know this. You would know at least my name.
There's so many comments in the chat. I don't want to look.
Do you want to say it now? Do you want to tell everyone?
No, you can do it.
Well, April Fools, everybody.
April Fools! Yeah, April Fools.
April Fools. My real name is Juan.
It is. My real name,
oh my
for those
God.
Of you who don't know, uh-oh. Is Juan Esprite.
He's Juan in a million.
Juan in a million.
Montoya.
I am Juan Esprite.
I'd like to give Bean some credit for calling out the April Fool's joke.
Yeah, absolutely. He jumped on it.
You know, we got Hein, who says he was expecting it, but he didn't actually say anything. And also, I think we got Paige too. I think we did.
Yeah.
If you look at that, if you look at that chat.
I like scrolling up pages like, please say April Fools. Please say April Fools.
That's why I said I can't say that right now. I'll say it later.
Awesome, guys. So happy to be here. So happy to not be fired from my podcast that I helped start. But I would say that if I had to step aside due to legality, there is no better team that I would want to take over than the current team.
Oh. Fun fact, there is no legal team here. I am HR, but I am not the legal team.
Joan is HR, though, and I have said, you know, all joking aside, I've made some really inappropriate jokes, some of them within the last half hour. Most of them off air. And
I think we almost caused a sibling argument. Paige says, I was confused because Frog tells me everything. He did not mention he was taking over the podcast.
Yeah. No, Paige, you know, the moment I heard, it would have gone right to you.
Which means that he is technically looking for that invite, Frank. So I'm just saying, like.
Oh, no, like anything could happen. Frank can tell me, you know, I got a pet mouse yesterday, and he actually talks. The only person who would know, my sister.
Yeah. I mean, I've been friends with these two cool cats for now a few years. Now, isn't it like 3 years now?
Yeah, it's been about 3 years.
Yeah. Hein says, in my defense, I'm already at 4 a.m. on April the 2nd. Yeah, that's true. Hein is in Europe. I heard he's in Slovenia. So,
oh, wow. Heinz, do they even have a full type day where you are? I know England has one, but it's not April 1st. They have like a different celebration.
Do they have a full day?
Yeah, the Festival of Fools.
Yes.
Oh, God.
I was like, I don't want to call it April Fools because it's not in April.
The Hunchback. I know that one. The hatchback of Honda Civic.
Oh, do you know that I spent maybe 2 hours one day listening to a YouTube episode about how Hellfire is the best Disney song ever?
It is. I don't care what anybody says. It
kind of is.
Excuse me. Have you watched Mulan? Do you know what it takes to make a man out of you? Let me tell you.
That's true. Oh, Mulan, I'll Make a Man Out of You is the... No. I'll Make a Man Out of You is like the last song, because they purposely did not let it be a musical after seeing the village destroyed, because there's a tonal shift in the story.
Mm.
Well,
there's
only
music in the first half.
Did you know, I didn't realize that was Donny Osmond.
Oh, yeah.
That song. I found this out like a couple of months ago.
And then the commander is played by the guy from Law & Order SVU. So there's that.
What?
Yeah. Wong is the character on SVU, and he plays Wang, Commander Wang in Mulan. He's the love interest.
I did not know that.
Yeah, he's all good. I would like to say that Mulan has, I would say, top music for me. Not, I'm sorry, Hunchback, but I'd say Lion King number one.
No, Lion King has the best music overall, okay. But Hellfire, based on the composition, is the best song.
Okay.
I'm saying it's Yupendi.
Yupendi is also like number two, I would say.
Isn't that from Lion King number two?
It is.
They weren't trying to say anything with that.
Oh my god.
Justin will sing that song specifically, Way Down in Your Panties. Like, that is the only way he will sing that song.
Wow.
But do we want to actually get back to the topic at hand, which is haunted art? Unless you want to say that this is all haunted.
I would like to get Justin's interpretations of songs in a different episode.
You
perhaps.
No, you don't. Okay. Tangent. My husband does this thing where he just repeats the words to the song over and over again.
Oh.
So the song that typically goes like, all the leaves are brown and the sky is brown.
Oh, boy.
Justin will go, all the leaves are brown and the sky is brown. Everything is brown. Like, he just keeps singing about how it's brown.
I do some shit like that where I just substitute every word in a song with meows.
Oh, my God.
So.
I just do every verse a pitch higher.
Mm. Oh, God.
We also say, instead of like, hot damn somewhere in the city, like, hot damn somewhere in the city, we'll go like, hot dogs somewhere in the city.
There's so many.
Frank's like, I'm gonna start singing that from now on.
No, so that song, actually, my parents have a black car from the 70s, and that's the theme song to their car, and they sing it when they're in that car. So it's just funny.
God.
So I should tell you the other one. We go, hot poo, I'm feeling shitty a lot too.
Wow.
Oh, God.
I'm going to call HR on Joan. Specifically, I'd like to call HR on Justin as well somehow. I don't know.
We are a very musical-based household.
Paige would like to say that we should get back to the spoops. We should do that.
Is my marriage not creepy enough for you
all?
Anyway, What picture would you like to talk about next, Stormfrog? I could click on any slide.
You know what? Let's show everybody the Rain Woman, because I only discovered this one today.
Okay. I actually have to pull up an article.
What's going on with her neck?
You can't just ask a woman what's going on with her neck, Frank.
Why not?
It's so. The reason this one really stuck out to me, the one that normally I'd love to do my research on whatever it is I'm going to talk about, but when I found this today, there was one line in the story that really stood out to me that was like, this is creepy because I have experience with this. So the artist, Svetlana, how do you say that? Teletz? Svetlana, if you're out there, if for whatever reason you listen to this, I apologize for butchering.
Don't do it, Svetlana. Don't listen to him. Don't do it.
Don't send the Rained Woman after me, Svetlana. Please, I have way too many demons already. My paralysis demon schedule is full. Please give him a break.
Oh my god.
I have too many skeletons in my closet. It's a graveyard in there. No more monsters, please. So the thing about this painting is that the artist herself claimed that she prepared her canvas. She had been commissioned to make something, but she had no idea what she was going to make. And then days and days and days later, she's just staring at it. And suddenly she claims it was like she felt like she was being watched, and that her hand just kind of pick up the pencil or the charcoal or whatever it is that she was, you know, using to sketch out what it was going to turn into, as if it was moving on its own, as if something supernatural was guiding her. And it took a couple hours to sketch it all out, get all the details. And over the next few days, she would paint this and she would talk about how she was just growing more and more unsettled. And after it was complete, you know, she was like, okay, let's sell this off to somebody. Let's get this off my hands. Well, it passed from one hand to the next, until it got to somebody who was like, not only will I give you this back, I'll pay you half of what I paid for it for you to take it, get it away from me. And it's because everyone who's had it was claiming that they felt like they were being watched. I think the last person who had it claimed that everywhere he looked, he was seeing these white eyes staring back at him, and he feared that if he did not return this painting, if he did not get rid of it, he would, quote, drown in the eyes. Which, to me, is an unsettling line in and of itself. But, you know, at first glance, you see the picture, like, okay, that's spooky. But the longer you stare at it, when you're like, oh, what's up with her neck? Oh, is that a hat? Is that her hair? What is this? As funny as we could pick some things out, there's just something about the serenity of the face that freaks me out. And again, the reason I really like this story, despite the fact it scared the hell out of me, is because I do have a painting that I gave away to a friend. And I believe I think I told you, Frank, about it. Frank is somebody else at some point.
I get told a few things.
Yeah, it may. I can't remember who I told. I've told so many people this at some point. One night, I painted on a canvas something I would later go to call the Red King. It was this...
I did see that one.
Yeah, this skull-like being with this very tall red crown. And it was a very, you know, Basquiat-style kind of thing. I don't know. I was just kind of, you know, I was fucking around for you know... lack of a better word. But after I had it one night after it was complete, and I went to bed and I had just the worst nightmares about it. And in the nightmare, the entire room is like bathed in a red light, and the painting is on the wall and it's just spinning rapidly. I woke up, I tore the thing off the wall, I hid it away for I don't even know how long. I think it was a couple of months, almost a year. And I had a friend, I told him about it, and he's like, oh, hell yeah, give me that, I'll take it.
Why would he say that, though? because this thing was spinning on my wall, maybe demonic energy. He's like, dude, hook me up.
You know, shout out to my friend Mike. He's a really cool dude. He's a really good guy. But the dude is like afraid of nothing. So when he was like, it's haunted, is it possessed? Give it to me. And it's at his, and he's hung it over his bed. And I'm like, don't ever show me that picture again. One time he snapped me the picture and I'm like, that's enough. That's enough. I don't want to see it anymore. So when this painting came up, I was like, I get it. I get what this odd feeling is over this art. And again, this kind of goes into, is it possible to unintentionally or even intentionally add some kind of energy into a painting that would otherwise affect the physical or spiritual or whatever you want to call it kind of realm? Yeah.
I feel like this has some parallels to Ghostbusters 2 in the Vigo painting where he's watching everybody at the museum.
You just wait. There's going to be a ghost nanny flying in stealing my baby one night.
I'm just worried that this person in the painting is going to take over Mike's body to rule again.
I feel like if the Red King possessed him, I would know.
I remember watching the Red King. I think you were just hanging out doing some editing on it. It was really cool. If you have it now, we'd love to see it.
I do not. Mike still has it.
No, I mean, like, don't you have a digital? I thought we saw a screenshot of it.
Oh God, I'd have to get Mike. You know what? Let me message him.
Okay, let's call Mike.
Let me message him and be like, hey man.
Hey, I know it's.
Frank loves to message somebody outside the show.
Never show me again. Can you show me that again?
Just, you know what, Stormfrog? I'll tell you what. Just DM me Mike's number and I'll ask him for photos.
Mike,
stop asking people for personal photos.
Give me personal photos of your bedroom, Mike. I want to see this, what you got in there.
Mike, send me a picture of the bed, please.
Can you send me a picture of your bed, please? I know you don't know me. I know I'm, 500 miles away in Chicago. Paige says, this is why Frank was fired. That's right. That is indeed the reason for shit like this.
I'm messaging him right now.
Frank wants to see pictures of his dryer, too.
I would like to see how big the opening is on Mike's dryer and window.
And see if he'll call you stepbro.
God.
Can he call me?
It's getting spookier and spookier.
It's getting something, all right. It's getting something, all right. Oh, look at Lord Cronus pop the old page emote in the chat. Hell yeah.
I just realized Lord Cronus said, Dirty Mike and the boys.
Oh my God.
Oh man. So yeah, I just messaged him. If he gets it to me in time, I'll send it and y'all can post it if y'all want.
Oh, I'd love to.
I'm freaked out by it, but
if he can send us that particular piece, we can use it for the cover of this show.
Oh, like Jesus Christ.
Podcast art.
Watch this act like a tulpa and more people like, oh, that shit's real. And fucking comes to life. Then what am I going to do?
How did you guys get so many views? Oh, it's, digital blood magic. It's no big deal.
That's how the world ended. That is how the world ended. I painted this stupid monster and it took on a life of its own. And then it went after its creator, just like every Frankenstein story.
You know, but we got that eclipse coming.
Like, yeah, but if it gets us like views, that's like, that's fine.
Yeah, I'm saying, like,
that's just the price of fame.
I think we should pop the Red King and the CERN particle accelerator during the eclipse and open up a portal and see.
I just realized how many followers that night. I just realized my Jesse, that night. Holy crap,
Jesse! That's the coolest thing ever. Eclipse topic night. Oh no, I'm extra excited.
Oh no.
We are. Slightly in the path of it, so we will our work is giving out eclipse glasses so we can go out and look at it, so that's pretty
I bought
fun.
Some Faraday bags for Lucky. My electronics in case there's some kind of
if my electronics fail that day, you all know why. Sorry.
Mike just messaged me back. He said stand by.
let me
get my charger so this phone don't die before I get it. We must stop the Red King. Oh yeah, got it right here.
Uh-oh. Oh no.
We're all about to be cursed tonight. Maybe a little bit. It's fine.
I'm going to put the Red King as my wallpaper on my computer. Do you think that might open up a portal if I do it right?
I laugh about it, but it genuinely does freak me out. It really does. And You can ask Paige. I'll put on the Conjuring movies as background noise to like help me fall asleep sometimes. Like it takes a I know that sounds weird. It takes a lot to really freak me out. This is one thing that really does freak me out. Curse me like you mean it.
You mean it.
Basically, we're all gonna leave cursed tonight. It's okay. Listen. First of all, we're a paranormal show, so I'm just expecting it at this point. It's not a if it'll happen, it's a when it'll happen. Second,
we don't have to like invite it, but sure, go on.
Second, Kay already has a lot of experience with this and was able to get away from it, so I'm not worried about it.
Yeah, but listen, I was able to leave the last house. I'm like locked in at an interest rate I'm never gonna get again, so I can't leave this one.
You know what's gonna be really funny? Where Joan's like, "Man, I got such a good deal on this new house, but it's actually your house." She's like, "Oh man, I'm moving to Portland." You sold her.
With all the paperwork I've done, that would be alarming if all of a sudden I was in Portland.
It'd be funny if like you're like, I don't know who this Hunter guy is, but his house is cheap. It's actually real haunted.
Justin has said that, like, if he could get a discount, he would buy a murder house.
Hell yes!
I would never.
Why not?
Okay, maybe I would buy it, but I wouldn't live in it.
What?
And I would hire a team to restore it, and I would never step foot in it myself.
One time I was on one of Stormfrog... No, I wasn't on. I was in one of Stormfrog's, like, stream chats, and they were, like, going through this haunted house. And everyone's like, we could have a room here. And I was like, guys, look, the plaster's cracked. No, we can't do this. Do you know how much that's going to be?
That's the thing you will quickly come to learn about my chat is we are all under the assumption that we can just live in haunted places, even in sewers, and we'll be completely fine. The monsters, they won't fuck with us. We'll be okay.
I'm just saying, you got to check for radon. You got to be checking for lead paint. There's cracks in the plaster. That's
fucking
structural.
Asbestos. Come on.
And if they're selling as is, you're never going to make your money back in a resale. That's all I'm saying. So want to move on to the next painting.
Move on to the next one. I'm going to read these comments you got. Bree saying, I'm sorry. I was going to read a comment.
I just sent it to y'all in our Discord chat.
Okay.
It's the first one. It's, like I said, it was just something I did up quick one night. But
Joan, you're
going to
share your screen on this one.
I don't want
to
hang
give
it on the wall.
Give me a second to pull it up.
Can you ask him to take another photo where he turns the flash off by chance?
Let me see if I can.
I need him to zoom out so I can see his bed.
No, stop it.
Can you please show us the bed?
My friend Frank.
My friend Frank really wants to see. No.
Oh.
Hold on.
What are you guys looking at? I'm confused.
I don't know. No,
it's okay. Don't look at this yet.
Don't look at him.
Don't look at me yet.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
I'm trying to do something. Don't look at me.
I remember Stormfrog was having a stream on the back rooms. I unfortunately did not make this comment. I think it was Rip Roar who was like, man, this Airbnb sucks.
Yeah, no, that's what they all do.
Oh. There we go. See?
Oh.
Yeah, so I'm not a big fan of it. I don't know,
he's kind of cute.
And see, at first I had good vibes, like, this is coming out great, and then afterward I stuck it on the wall, and I was like, that's fine. I went to bed. Nope, never again. So now it's his, probably displayed over his bed. He loves it. I do not.
I mean, he's got sort of like a David Schwimmer type of vibe to him.
He's, you know what? I see it. This is definitely... I'll stalk Jennifer Aniston kind of feel, you know? Mm,
yeah, yeah.
It feels like that.
I mean, a little different. I mean, like a closely related relative, yeah. Maybe.
Oh, yeah, definitely. But yeah, no, it's... Like I said, it goes back to the whole painted... The rain woman. Sorry, I keep wanting to say the painted lady. That's from Avatar. the rain woman. It's another case of the artist making something and then all of a sudden it just, something doesn't feel right about this.
Yeah, definitely. I love that we're doing this topic. I was looking forward to this for months.
Yeah.
Oh man, then you're going to love our next one. What do you
seduce
call it?
Me with your wares,
yeah,
Sir Frog.
Death and the Child, also known as the more morbidly titled The Dead Mother. Edvard Munch, he is another famous artist who you most likely have seen his most popular work, which is The Scream. You know, that little bald man on the bridge doing this.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up in the beginning.
Yeah, so he painted this called The Dead Mother. Just a child, you know, devastated by the loss of their mother. And yes, it is a very morbid subject, but it's the stories that come from people who have experienced the painting, especially those who have like hung it in their galleries and their museums, have claimed that they can hear like a child crying. Like they might be walking down the hallway of the wing that this is in, and they'll hear a child whimpering and crying coming from the area that this picture is hung in. There are others who claim that the eyes of the child will follow you, which I feel like is a very common, eyes of this painting follow me kind of thing. But the other thing that I found very unsettling was that there are those who claim that they'll pass by this and the mother's gone. The bed is empty. And they swear the child's expression has changed as if they look frightened. Whereas, you know, you look here, they look sad or maybe even slightly surprised. I don't know. It's kind of hard to read this child's face. But for the dead character to go missing rather than the light, you would expect, I saw the child run across the hallway. You know, the mother is missing. Of all the things that could be horrific, that is what unsettles me.
I also heard a couple of people say that instead of the mother being missing, they'll see the bed sheets move in the painting.
You know, it'd be a great idea for a video game. You know, like in Mario 64, the idea is you're jumping into these paintings and then going into that world.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be great if there was a video game where you jump into like these horror paintings and then go into that particular world?
There is a video game that like you take a picture and then you have to move it.
That's Slenderman.
And then that unlocks things.
Oh no. Well, I know within Slenderman, you run around.
Fatal
you run around
frame,
with the camera.
Yeah. Well, see, there's also layers of fear. Which also, you know, for the gaming community out there, if you are, and I know there's a lot of gamers out there listening to this podcast.
Yeah.
You want spooky and art all rolled into one. Layers of Fear, the first one and the second one, both terrific games. Both very much they had to have been inspired by some of these paintings. I know, I absolutely get the vibe of it because there's a couple of paintings in there that actually look like the first one we looked at, the Saturn Devouring His Child. A lot of them look like that. I don't know.
The other thing I heard about this painting that gave me chills is Edvard lived through really bad cases of tuberculosis when it was at its highest. And they believe that his mother is the one depicted in this, but they're not sure who the child is. Some think it might be his sister, mm-hmm. and the reason that she has this expression as a child is because she is realizing that she is next, because she is one of the next of his family members to die from tuberculosis.
Oh, wow.
So it's like a young child coming to terms with mortality.
And if you think about
it... I heard that and that gave me chills, personally.
Yeah, I just got a chill.
It's just something about capturing these moments. Like, it's one thing to take a photo... especially like, you know, way back when they would photograph the dead with the relatives, like they're propped up or they're in their casket. That's unsettling, but something about taking the time to make the sketch, to make the painting, you are focusing literal energy on creating this image, on bringing it into this world. And you have to, the best way I could say it is you acknowledge there is an energy that goes into these things. Effort, you know, intention. And to paint, if that is in fact his mother, in that state, and then paint the memory of his sister at that age, because there's no way he was sitting there doing this as it was happening.
Mm-hmm.
To put all of this in there, there's a lot of... I guess manifestation's really the only word that I can think of.
Yeah.
But
it's it's interesting. It's a lot. Also, like, as I said, I tried to do a little research on these things, and like hearing that Edvard actually ended up with his abusive father as his only family member, and then he created these paintings.
Yeah.
It's very interesting to paint death and innocence together in this way, and not almost feel like wanting to go back to those times in a weird way, being it more simpler. So, yeah, it's just, yeah, it's a, the painting gives me chills, but more for the background. I'd also like to mention it's very interesting that she's covering her ears and not her eyes. Mm-hmm. And I do wonder the symbolic behind that.
If I had to guess, and again, this is a very morbid thought, but tuberculosis is a lot of hacking, it's a lot of wheezing, it's a lot of drowning in your own body. A death rattle, maybe, being stifled by the child's hands over the ears, who doesn't know how to cope with what's happening.
Oh, God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which really just kind of cranks this up a notch.
Yeah.
It's even if this is not haunted, it is haunting.
Yeah.
I learned about the death rattle a couple of years ago. I was editing an intro for our Halloween episode, and I wanted to actually put in real life 911 calls that are really scary.
Oh, Jesus.
Some of those are like super scary and potentially traumatic. I ended up not doing it because it was too much.
Yeah, it's a lot.
I was editing. You know, I don't mind listening to that shit late at night. So I was editing or you know, looking for material at like, I don't know, like 2 a.m. I fell asleep and I woke up at like 3 a.m. to like a video, because it just kept playing. Like YouTube will just keep playing related videos. And I woke up and there's a video called Death Rattles. And I'm like, what's a death rattle? And it was just a compilation of death rattles. I'm like, oh my Christ, what am I doing? What is this? This is so bad. Don't ever do that. I would not recommend to
it. No, not at all.
1 out of 10.
Turn your autoplay off, everybody.
And isn't it weird that even though paintings are silent, you can almost
hear you definitely have perceptions about sound based on, you know.
Especially when somebody tells you that this in fact is someone who died of tuberculosis, your first thought is coughing, of hacking, and all these other things, which kind of again breathes up, well, on our, and ironically, breathes life into this painting.
Yeah.
But I wish I could say, moving on to a lighter note, but we really aren't. The crying boy.
This one
is very well known across those who are keen on reading creepypastas or, you know, other paranormal investigators, internet sleuths. If you've investigated the paranormal and haunted things, you've come across the crying boy just as surely as you have come across Robert the doll or Annabelle or any of that. The crying boy, my thoughts on this are just don't have it. Never have this in your house. Don't have it, because I can't remember how many houses it was, but this painting has been in way too many house fires for it to just be coincidence.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Sometimes
it's like the only thing that survives it.
Well, yeah, there's actual multiple ones of them. It was in London, and I don't know why, but back then people wanted crying kid paintings in their houses. And a lot of the houses that had these would burn down, and the painting would be the only thing left. Greg and Dana Newkirk actually have one, and they were doing an experiment last year when they were touring, where everybody put like a negative thought or emotion or memory into this crying boy painting that they had painted of Greg himself, and they wanted to see if you could transfer that energy into a not haunted painting and turn it into something haunted. I don't know what happened with that, but oops, I just knocked a Coke bottle over.
No, oh, it God. Was the ghost.
Yeah.
This one?
I personally will take everything with a grain of salt. I hope that there is something else out there. But before I just jump to conclusions, I like to kind of weigh the reality of things. The crying boy is one example where I'm just going to give it to the supernatural. A point for them. The fact that it has been involved in so many fires and has survived. Incredible. Because canvas, it goes up like that. That thing should have been the first thing to burn up. If you're telling me an entire living room set burned down before the painting, which was also probably hung in there in the viewing gallery for guests to see, although I don't know why you would want guests to see that, something's up. Something's up. And is it malevolent? Yeah, probably.
We got Hines saying he cries out the fires before they burn him. That's how he survives.
He cries as a painting. Out the fire, yeah.
Yeah, he gets it. The tears.
Can you imagine if that is the case? If somebody who was in the fire reported seeing water dripping from the canvas that kept flames from like licking at it?
Yeah, I mean, there is stuff like that. There's always those crying statues around the world that happen randomly.
Oh, you know? Yeah, that's right. And it's always their crying blood. Almost all.
Some of them.
A lot of them are. Yeah.
We gotta do a show on that.
Except for that one statue, I think it's of Ganesh that drinks milk.
Yeah.
I think that's pretty cool.
Let's do that topic in the future.
There's also that one Japanese doll that hair keeps growing.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that one. Yeah, Frank's over here. He's like, oh hell no.
No, I want to do a show. I want to dedicate a topic to like crying statues and that kind of thing.
Frank,
I think
what we need to do at some point, we get the entire cast together. We spend a night at the Clown Motel with this painting hanging in the same room.
Oh, yes, please.
With the doll who's growing her hair. So like, you know, I can braid her hair. You can drink milk with the elephant statue.
You know,
it'll be great.
Jesse and Kay are saying no, but I already have both of their addresses, so I'll just send it to them.
That
sounds so threatening. Stop it.
There's a big life size clown HR. Doll that we'll have Kay sit next to all night.
I don't do clowns or dolls.
How about both?
So while touring houses, we saw this one house, and it looked like it was supposed to be like a teenage girl's bedroom, but like it was older. And we walked in, and I went, "Why? Why are there clown paintings in here?"
Hi.
My husband goes, "What are you talking about?" Well, and then like walked in, and there was at least four clown paintings in this one, only in this one room.
You know,
and I'll tell you, if you have a house that has clown paintings in it, it's usually the house that has clown paintings in it. It was this room.
My parents have not just clown paintings. My parents in their bathroom have this ceramic of a clown taking a bath that's really creepy.
Oh, no.
I'm going to text my mom right now and see if she can send me a picture.
Maybe this is just me. I could be misremembering, but I really don't think I am. It's either the 80s or the 90s, where there was this really weird obsession with crying clown paintings.
Yeah, no, you're right. That was the thing.
There was like an artist that was well known for making crying
and they became
clowns.
And everybody wanted crying clowns in their house. And I can't imagine why you would want that. It's the same thing with the crying boy. People wanted pictures of crying children painted in their house. Now they want crying clowns. The two things that should not be crying, that should be laughing and having a good time, they want pictures of them miserable.
Do you think they have the crying clown painting facing the crying child painting, so it's like a perpetual tear thing?
Oh, God.
So everyone's crying all the time?
Oh, they cancel out each other's demonic energy.
Or they just create, like, a portal in the middle of
Brian
sad
is right.
demonic
People
energy.
Like and by the way, going back into the chat, remember how we mentioned how the boy, the painting just does not burn up for whatever reason?
Mm-hmm.
There's a thing on TikTok, semi-related, I guess. Somebody found a Cheeto out on the street and it was raining. And for whatever reason, the rain just does not touch the Cheeto. It makes like a perfect circle around it.
Holy shit, that's the most paranormal shit.
Right? I don't see
it's the most paranormal thing I've ever heard in my life.
And
Charlie and or Frank, whoever edits this, put the X-File sound in right
there's
right when he says it doesn't get wet.
There's no shadow over it. It's just in a parking lot. It looks like it's just in some store parking lot, and the rain is hitting everywhere but that Cheeto. It's like it's a blessed Cheeto or something.
Sounds like I should have a boat made of Cheeto.
Boat made of Cheeto, right.
I don't know if that's a good idea, Joan, if you want to survive, you know.
It doesn't get wet. You heard the man. It doesn't get wet.
Whatever that Cheeto is made out of has to be the same shit that the crying boy is made out of, because neither were destroyed.
You gotta buy a bunch of crying boy paintings and make a boat out of that, out of the canvas that it's on.
Oh, Jesus.
That's gonna be helpful if I'm in a fire.
Oh, that's right. Line the inside of your oven.
And you know, speaking sacred Cheeto, and speaking of, you know, the crying boy, the next and last painting that I, you know, this thought would be good for tonight's subject, was The Hands Resist Him. This one blew up really not all that long ago. This was accompanied by a bunch of creepy pastas. I remember seeing it in a couple of like the most haunted top five whatever videos. And it's really not that old of a painting. You know, it was just done in the 70s. And when I first saw this, I wasn't too freaked out. It's painted well enough that from a distance, it kind of does look like it's just like an old Polaroid or something. But then when you really get a look at the details and you realize the little girl is actually a doll and that there are actual handprints very subtly placed on the windows behind this child through a window that is basically a void into nothing, all of a sudden this becomes very, I feel like ominous.
Joan, can you zoom in by chance a bit? I need to see their expressions.
Yeah, it's really funny that you mentioned that in the chat, Frank, because I was going to say, hold on. I want to view this as
we got Alex Jones and
Alex Jones is back.
We got Alex Jones and Gonzalo Martinez in the chat. Welcome in, fellas.
I was going to say, Frank, that I agree that if this had come out today, if you'd show me this picture today, I would go, oh, that's AI.
Yeah, 100%.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's what I find very unsettling about it.
Why are her arms, they look like two different sets of arms, and like the leg, she looks like a giant doll.
So
she is a giant doll.
You just said.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm stupid. I'm just looking at it. I'm not really listening. Who's the clown now?
So, fun fact about this painting. Rather, I guess, I really don't think this is a fun fact, but it is a fact. The little boy is the self-portrait of the artist when he was a child. And why this is called The Hands Resist Him?
Oh no, they're behind the door.
Yeah, they're all behind the door. So, I actually tried to look up. I tried to research. What is this supposed to represent? What is the point of this? Because almost everything has a story to it. And in this case, there really isn't one. The artist himself even was kind of like, I was just compelled to paint this and I let whoever views it to come up with their own theory as to why it is the way it is. And some people have theorized that this reflects with childhood trauma. The doll itself represented some kind of perpetual innocence, because it's just a doll. It's never going to change. It's always just this child holding, I believe it's like flowers or something. I don't know. I've never really zoomed in to its hands, but it is holding something.
It looks like, honestly, a toothpaste bottle with like a silly straw coming out of it.
Okay, maybe he ate a lot of toothpaste as a child, which would probably explain why he ended up painting this.
I'll see if I can zoom in anymore. It doesn't work. Never mind. This is what you're getting. Sorry.
I know you mentioned handprints, but they kind of look like a whole bunch of doll hands.
Oh, they do.
Reaching towards me, towards them.
Oh, they do. Especially considering the size of the hands of, say, and like the doll or the child. Those are about the same handprint size.
I think it's also disturbing, and like, it's weird once again that this was in 1972,
because
this also feels very much like TikTok hauntings, where like you're supposed to be looking at something that looks normal, a kid posing for a picture, minus the doll, but then like the TikToks are like the "Did you see that?" and then like you scroll in and you see something in the background. It feels very reminiscent of that, which odd considering that's not how haunted medium was coming up during that time.
Yeah, and from what I remember, I think he was commissioned like $200 every so often to make some paintings, and this is one he claims just, you know, I got to provide them with something, so let me make this. And it just so happened to be one of his most foreboding works. And for me, I think it's the face of the child, and maybe it's the shadow work itself that, yeah, this does look like you clipped this out of an old photo in Photoshop and just slapped it onto a very ominous background.
He's making a very adult face for a child. So I think there's also a little bit of uncanny valley in that sense. Also, has no eyebrows.
Yeah.
I have a theory about no eyebrows.
We got Justin Moore in the chat. Apparently this one is one of a series, according to Wikipedia.
One of a series? Oh. I can't even begin to imagine what the rest of this series looks like.
Mr. Justin, can you link us to the Wikipedia when you have a moment? Thank you.
Justin
Thank you,
is
sir.
My husband, by the way, Stormfrog.
No. Oh, she's his wife.
I'm his wife.
That's right.
I And while we're waiting on that, the thing that always stuck out to me about this painting is above the child's head. Some people say, oh, that's a moon. That's like a crescent moon. Others claim that is a smile.
Looks like it could be a clock, too.
Yeah, some people say it's a clock. To me, I've always seen it as kind of like a Cheshire Cat kind of grin, because coupled with the handprints and the hands on the glass, with a foreboding smile that's a lot higher, to me, this was a representation of some kind of childhood trauma. I won't go into detail. I'll leave that up for you to kind of figure out on your own. But that's what made me feel very unnerved about this painting. And again, it goes back to the fact that the painter's like, it's whatever you think it is.
It's interesting that you said that, because for some reason I thought it was like a peephole. Like, it's actually wood paneling, but you can still see the hand. Like, it's one of those weird things where it's like, is it glass or is it wood?
Yeah.
And is that a transitional into whatever actually is in there?
Yeah. There's another theory that says that that's actually a hole cut into the glass, and that's just a highlight of where that part might be, where the light might be hitting it. And I guess maybe, although the lighting isn't directly coming from above. So it'd be kind of weird if that is it. But then again, it goes back to it's whatever you think it is.
The lighting looks like it's coming from off and to the right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think
the name helps it seem like there's not supposed to be more we're looking into. Mm-hmm. Like, the hands resist him brings up the question of, why? What's going on with the hands?
Yeah. The other thing that's freaking me out a little bit about this is I know everybody finds that doll eyes are really creepy. Like, you hear about people saying, oh, that doll's eyes are following me.
Mm-hmm.
But she just straight up doesn't have any.
Yeah, she doesn't have eyes. And it almost looks like the boy doesn't have pupils.
Yeah.
They complete each other.
They complete her eyes, each other.
Her black eyes could become his pupils. I don't know. You know, it's always like dolls have always freaked me out. My mom used to own like a bunch of porcelain dolls. And like in the olden days, they had these dolls, like depending on how you position the doll, the eyes would open. Right.
Yeah.
And then I don't know if it's just like a product of the time when they, you know, they weren't great, but like those eyes were never in sync with each other. So the eyes would like, be like kind of open, kind of shut, no matter what
the
you did.
The wonky-eyed dolls. Yeah.
And those dolls were the scariest thing growing up. She had like three or four of those. I have no idea why somebody would be like, oh, I think this looks like a collectible. You know, like when you really think about like the Funko Pop culture now, like back in the olden days, they were collecting those creepy dolls instead of those.
Precious moments.
Oh, the precious moments. And the whole Precious Moments Chapel. That's a whole nother can of
worms. I was going to say, speaking of haunted art, the Precious Moments Chapel is like depressing.
What is that?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
you know what the Precious Moments Chapel is?
It's in Kentucky, right? It's in Kentucky.
Yeah.
And like, it's the guy who created Precious Moments, and he was religious and like dedicated a whole museum to it, but he made this chapel where he made every mural in it. And like,
what the fuck?
Like, it's a lot about dedication to art too, because he was like, oh, I painted the ceiling, but it wasn't a bright enough blue, so I went and repainted the whole ceiling so it was a bright enough blue. But there's two murals in there that are dedicated to his dead sons.
Yep. And
we could...
The doors to the chapel, which are all hand-carved, were hand-carved by the artist who specifically taught himself woodworking so he could make those doors.
The doors.
It was the only reason he learned that craft.
Yeah. No, like, it's not creepy. It's sad. But highly look into the Precious Moments, like, yeah, museum.
And if you don't know what the Precious Moments themselves are, again, I think this is a 90s thing. At least that's what I remember seeing them growing up whenever, you know, my mom used to collect dreamsicles, which are these little angel things. And I think they were along the same lines as Precious Moments. Precious Moments are usually like little cartoony looking children with a Christian theme to them, like little angels praying, or, you know, they're dressed like the apostles, or they're holding a lamb. They're celebrating Christmas, stuff like that. It's all very innocent.
In post, we will put pictures up of them. But like, if you see one if you're American and you see one, you'll go, oh.
Yeah, chances are you have seen them in some way, shape, or form. Especially like if you remember the Hallmark stores. Holy hell, there were so many of those things.
We still got those up here.
Oh, they took ours away. They stopped feeding me my Beanie Baby supply and they got shut down.
Oh, they still exist and they still have Beanie Babies over here.
Yep.
Man. But yeah, no, the, you know, tying everything up together, putting it in a big, beautifully haunted package with a big macabre bow on top. These paintings that we've looked at all do circle back around to the question, is it possible that inanimate objects... and I'm not talking like this mirror is haunted or that jewelry is cursed. I'm talking somebody took the time to pour some kind of emotion, some kind of feeling into this canvas, into this, you know, this wood paneling or whatever it is that they painted on or whatever they drew on, and manifested so much energy into it that it did inadvertently take on a life of its own. And is it residual? Long after the artist is dead, can it still haunt this earth? Case in point, the Goya paintings. Case in point, Edvard Munch, who's been dead a long time. Whereas with The Hands Resist Him, and I assume the Rain Woman's artists, I assume they're still alive. Chances are they probably are. You know, when they pass... At some point, will these paintings be even more haunted? Will there be even more legend behind it? Or is it because the artist is alive, people can be like, no, it's not haunted. Even they claim some spooky stuff where they say, I just did it for no reason, like The Hands Resist Him. You know, where does the paranormal fit in, and when does it take hold of these paintings, I guess is really what I'd be wanting to know.
You know, I don't believe in many things that we talk about on this show, and it's no secret that I'm the skeptic amongst us.
Frank just, yeah.
However,
this show is bullshit, but I'm here.
Dude, I felt bad this one day. We were talking about the Baba Yaga, and we talked about Baba Yaga for like 2 hours. We were talking about John Wick for 2 hours, and then at the end of the show, when we get on final thoughts, I'm like, yep, definitely not true. But this is something where I actually do think that there is truth behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And even if it's something where it's not outright haunted, I think that there's a real power in our ability to make things as such. You know, we have the power to change our perceptions with things. Think about, like, you know, medication that, you know, the placebo, right? It doesn't work, but you make it real.
Placebo effect.
And taking that same thought, if you're scared enough of artwork or a painting or any of these, I think it would be exactly the same as if it were actually haunted. So then you get into an area of like simulacra or simulation. Like, is it actually haunted if you can't tell the difference whether it's like a placebo type of thing or not, right? Mm-hmm. So I definitely believe in this. Saying. So it's amazing.
Yeah.
We had Papa Frog in the chat, by the way. Shout out to Papa Frog.
Where was he at?
I think it's not a big surprise that I'm also like one of those people who believe in a lot of like the energy you put into something mm-hmm. is like what you get out of it. Mm-hmm. So like there has to be something to be said that like paintings and most art are created to invoke some kind of emotion.
Yeah.
And if an inanimate object can create emotion without it being explained, mm-hmm. isn't that in a way supernatural?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Very much so. I had a friend who's a Wiccan who one time was explaining to me that a lot of, because I was just asking him, how do blessings work? How do curses work? How does all this stuff work? And he was explaining to me that it's intent. It is intent that gives such things powers. If somebody is blessing you, it is their intention for all good things. If somebody is cursing, it is intention for harmful and terrible things. And it is the intent that is the fuel. And if you've ever, and I assume we all have, drawn something, whether it was a school project or maybe you're just bored and you're just doodling, there's intent for what you're creating. And
that's the real thing.
Yeah, very, very much. And if I could liken it to anything, voodoo dolls, whether you believe in them or not, the people who make them, they know what they're making them for. We almost all know what a voodoo doll is for. And I guarantee you, whether you believed in it or not, if you found one that looked like you, you would have a bit of a chill run up your spine. Because also, there's a glint of belief that this might actually work.
If you really want to also get scared, on that same note that proves this intent that we're talking about, mm-hmm. there's actually a cult that is online on YouTube, and it's blood over intent.
What?
Where people are worshiping Satan. There's a guy who says that he is Satan. And the guy who's running this cult says that people must, he's something along the lines of, in order to be saved from a catastrophic event that's coming, you have to follow him, write your intent to be saved and to save those around you, and you write it on a piece of paper and you're recording for YouTube, and then you stab your own self, and then you like you smear your blood across, or you could write it in blood. And it's one of the craziest real rabbit holes on the internet.
Oh, Jesus.
This guy has amassed followers because he had said publicly that there's only like 400,000 or 500,000 available slots for salvation.
What the hell?
HR note, we do not condone doing this. Oh, do so not you, do that. You, anyway, go on.
You got to buy the battle thing. Pass into salvation?
No, seriously.
What religion don't you need to buy the battle pass into something?
I'm just saying it's a real thing where people take their intent, and it doesn't always have to be, I want to be saved. It could be money. It could be promotion. It could be romantic stuff. They put their intent down and they smear their blood on it. Mm-hmm. If you look up blood over intent on YouTube, you're going to see a lot of people that discuss the topic. And you're also mm-hmm. going to see actual videos of people who pierce themselves
and
rub their blood over their intent.
That's
a real thing. Blood magic within the realm of, you know, people who do believe in witchcraft is some of the most powerful shit
that
is part of that belief system.
It depends on the magic you're looking into. So just be careful.
Yeah.
I just understand that blood, you don't mess around with blood magic. And that's,
you don't mess around with any magic that involves bodily functions in general, depending on what it is. It also, the blood that you use is very dependent on what you're doing.
Yeah.
So for the example, period blood is a lot different than vein blood in magic intention.
Yeah.
So, well, no. Just like, so, okay.
No, you're right.
I'm out of here.
Yeah, you're right. That's a very valid point.
Okay.
The idea.
I'm gonna sign out. Actually.
You're good, Jesse. Have a good night.
Yeah, I'm gonna sign out. I got overtime tomorrow at work, so I'm gonna talk to you guys later.
I know we're overtime. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, I'll see you guys later. Night.
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 Right. You scared off Jesse Joan. You scared
Whatever.
Her off.
I'm gonna still say it anyway, just so people know.
Okay.
So vein magic, or vein blood, that's life giving blood.
Yeah.
So that intensifies things.
Mm-hmm.
Where period blood is an interesting contrast because it is dying blood, because mm-hmm. it is something that's being shed.
Yeah.
So you do that for like rejuvenal magic and things like that. So It's just, or some cultures use it for blood spells, or love spells. I don't agree with that, but I have a weird thing about love spells.
And again, meshing that into what tonight's topic was about, there are artists out there who do paint with blood. There's,
yes.
In fact, there's one I can recall. There are two in particular that I knew one. The other one I just read about, the one that I'd known, this guy, he would paint. He was really good at, like, he was really good at painting, but his medium was always his own blood. And, you know, he obviously take it from his wrist and he would paint and he'd make these really cool things. But one day he just stopped posting. And I don't know whatever happened to him. And I've not seen anything since.
Once again, just as an HR note, we don't suggest doing this.
Yeah, I don't think
just as an HR note.
I don't think it's a good thing. You know, if you're, I don't know, even as an artist myself, I don't see myself ever doing that. But there was also, and you can actually look this one up, there is an artist who would regularly have his blood drawn and he would freeze it. And then one day he made a sculpture of his own head, a bust of himself carved out of his own frozen blood.
Oh
yeah. If you have some kind of hemophobia, don't look it up. But otherwise, if you are a fan of sculpture and you can, I'm not going to say you can appreciate it, but if you can be wowed, it is very well done. It is very well carved. This guy's 100% a sculptor. Like, he's good. But yeah, that's giving life to art on a whole new level.
Yep. Yeah. As I said before, we don't suggest doing
that. Don't do that. I don't think those are haunted. I don't think those are supernatural, but they are. They're out there.
That thing we talked about. Don't do that.
Don't do that.
Any of that. Don't
do what Donnie Don't does.
Yeah, don't even make haunted art. Don't do that. Don't intentionally do that. Whether you believe in it or not. I can only imagine it would end in a Frankenstein-esque where it's gonna come after its creator.
Yeah.
But yeah, those were what I had for us tonight.
Kay, what are you thinking about all this stuff?
It's a little freaky. I definitely believe that, you know, if you're putting intent and energy into something when you're creating it, that it can definitely harbor that energy.
Oh yeah. Very much so. That is 100% my belief on that too. It's whatever you're trying to manifest. I think if you believe hard enough in something, who knows, maybe it can be manipulated.
So I know we're talking about this in a very scary way, mm-hmm. but I was just thinking that I have a ridiculous print in my kitchen, mm-hmm. which I kind of want to manifest into reality now. So I bought this print from TJ Maxx because it was so ridiculous. And it is a picture of a chicken with a flower crown and a diamond necklace.
Can you get it? Like, can we see it? Them.
No, it's in my kitchen.
Go get it. What's the problem?
It's in the door of the kitchen.
No, don't take your camera with you. Just get up and go grab it.
This is where we see Joan walking through her house, and it's just a split second, but on the corner of the screen, we'll see the crying boy.
Right. Joan, can you please send me photos of the inside of your house, please?
Well, because I'm not going to live there soon. Yeah, I will send you photos.
Yes.
So.
Three for three.
I will send pictures in the Discord of it later. I am not getting up right now to get it off.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because then my husband will go, what are you doing?
He's watching the show. He's not going to ask you questions. He knows we're wacky.
Justin, if you're watching and you can get Henrietta off the wall.
You've named the chicken?
Yeah, her name's Henrietta.
You've given it a name. You've Love given it. It life.
She deserves a name.
You have named
She's
it.
She's glorious.
The
She's
power so extra. Of names applies.
Okay, I'm going to go get her. Hold on. Wait.
Yes.
We hyped her enough about Henrietta.
I keep looking at Kay's webcam, and because I can see the hallway, I'm just expecting something to, like, peek through. I've seen way too many movies.
You know
I've
what?
I've seen way too many movies.
Stormfrog, she's got a cat that scared me once, man. The cat walked into the room. What's his name? I forgot the cat's name.
Harrison.
Harrison. Harrison walked into the room once and scared me because I was not expecting anything in her background. Mm-hmm. And before tonight, she actually had a much darker webcam.
Yeah.
So, like, it's more in the shadows.
So you just saw the eyes?
I didn't see the eyes, but that freaks me out, too. In real life, did you see eyes? Oh, my God.
Oh, wow.
That is a very regal-looking chicken.
Is she not beautiful?
She's
watch
extra.
This become the next haunted painting.
Look at this chicken.
They say you
she's got some big, I don't know what this part is called, but she's got some big ones right here.
Oh, that's a, oh God, I
it's
knew
the gobbler.
I'm holding the painting and I'm still HR. Do not talk about my
I'm
chicken's
about
breast.
Chicken anatomy. It's not talking about breasts. I'm talking about her, the red things.
There's a word for that. Oh my God. What is that called? That's the.
Bree says Queen Harrietta. Yep. Oh God, he's looking it up.
This is going to bother me. I knew the word for it.
What are the chicken dangly thingies? Your dad would like to say that it's her giblets.
The waddle.
I would take that.
It's waddle. Called the waddle.
Someone's
waattle. Yes.
The waddle.
Giblets are anything on a chicken that you don't recognize.
The giblets.
I also have a series of like paintings in my podcast room. I'm not taking those down right now.
That
are like one of those
that
like the more you look, the creepier things you see in it.
Oh, I don't
like
that.
It's purposely painted that way.
Why do you have paintings like that in a different room, though?
In my podcast, because I have a whole background. It's spooky in here.
Here's what we'll do: we'll make a painting with the intent of it being haunted on the eclipse. I'll send it to Joan. Joan will kind of put some kind of blessing thing on it. Then we'll send it to Kay, who will put whatever kind of energy she wants to. Then we'll send it to you, Frank, and you'll keep it for like however long and let us know if anything happens.
Yes.
Why would I have to keep it? We'll send it to, what do you want me to do? Bury it in the backyard? I can't do that. I don't have a backyard.
You'll be the one who destroys it if it gets out of hand.
What is it, a horcrux? I can't do that.
It's not environmentally nice to bury your things. They say you should throw it away at a trash can at a crossroad.
Yeah, there you go.
Listen,
do that.
I'm not Harry Potter. I cannot kill a Horcrux. Don't be telling us to make a Horcrux that I can't kill.
You're gonna stab it with a basilisk
fang. I'm gonna get the sword of Gryffindor. I don't know.
Yeah,
that sounds like a horrible idea, though.
Bree says, "Hang it on the white wall." Yeah, right over your shoulder.
Listen, I think we could add. Honestly, if you want us to, you know, individually put our own energy into it, that's fine. I already have Kay's address. You could forcibly send her something with the other thing that I'm forcibly sending. I forgot what that was already, but I'll be forcibly sending.
Go out to the mailbox and it's just going to be scorched and melted.
you're gonna hear a knock.
Except for the
your
crying
door.
Boy that'll be inside.
Yeah, you like open the door to the burned mailbox. You open the door, the crying boy's in the back.
Oh no! Oh no! No, Kay's gonna hear a knock on her door. She opens it up. There's just this brown paper wrapped square. She opens it up. It's a painting, and inside it just says, "He's your problem now."
Oh gosh!
We've named him Timothy, and he's yours.
There's a little crying sound coming from inside the brown paper thing. Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, it's kind of like a card, like the birthday card when you open it a little.
It's a precious moments haunted painting.
We could have AI generate that. You guys want? Hey, I have AI in the Discord. Should I share my screen? We can.
No,
give it a
we're not
for
supporting
that?
AI oh, God, as no. art.
I'm doing
we're
it.
We're not
I don't
supporting
care what
AI
else.
As art.
Hold on. Where? Hold. What do you, what, maybe, what did we say it was? Precious moments. Precious moments.
Precious moments. Precious horror haunted. Story. Somebody's gonna hear this podcast. They're gonna pitch this idea, and next summer, the horror event of the century is gonna be our story that we came up with.
Good thing that this is recorded, so I can go to them and be like, "Excuse me, I'm HR."
I just hope if they do like make all of this into a film, I want to be played by Jake Gyllenhaal, please.
I
want to
be played by Danny DeVito.
Oh man, and you got the good one.
I was gonna have my character written into somebody else. They just combine some of us, and they're like, "Yeah, that's one person now."
My character to be Danny DeVito, but as Oingo Goblogian.
Oh, imagine that for the haunted art gallery. But first,
I think this should be
allow me to destroy your gallery.
Bullshit.
Another reason Frank got fired. Yes, Paige. I think, actually, we shouldn't make this a movie. I think it should be a musical, and I think it should be a one-man musical by Danny DeVito.
You know what?
I think
let's do it.
I think you should just be all of us wearing different
yes,
things.
Yes, in the
like,
one-man show.
Like
we'll
for
put,
me.
We'll props.
Let's just make a haunted painting of Danny DeVito and send it to him.
Yeah. But if he plays me, he can just wear a white turtleneck.
Oh, you're not wearing the white turtleneck tonight.
I'm not.
Oh my god. This
go change right now.
Stormfrog. This person has been wearing the same
this
white
person,
turtleneck.
She has a name
for
what
like months,
names,
and then
Frank?
We called her out on it, and then she put a ski hat on the one night. It was fabulous.
Thanks, person.
Look.
Let me tell you.
There's nothing wrong with having your outfit because, as my chat knows, it's the beanie and it's,
oh, yeah.
It's my sleeveless old band t-shirt with a little skull and crossbones on the corner. Like, that is the Stormfrog fit.
I have much respect for that ski hat that came out. I don't know if some of our keen-eyed viewers or listeners had noticed it, but if you watch our end credits, not the beginning credits, but the end credits, I actually changed out Kay's video. So in that video, she's wearing the hat in the end credits after that show. Only keen-eyed people would notice that. What's
which
that?
Show? Which
so,
show?
Do you remember like the show that you wore the hat? The ski hat.
Okay.
This is so descriptive. She's asking which show she wore the hat at.
I don't remember what show. I don't know.
You know
I don't even
the
care.
Hat.
I just thought it was funny.
The hat. You wore it.
I can look it up. I can look it up. I can look it up. But
Bree said,
I gotta find it.
Bree said the entire for the or Danny DeVito cast, he's going to spend the entire movie trying to become pure. Completely shaved and covered in hand sanitizer.
I just want to be pure.
I just want to be pure. Greatest episode. My favorite episode.
This is all so good and so great and so fun, but I do think we should wrap
yeah.
it up
yeah.
and then
we've
we can have our...
gone over the time.
We
yeah.
could have our super secret meeting that we always have yeah. when Stormfrog's
we'll just,
in
we'll
town.
Just, we'll just like chop after. This episode in half and the rest is bonus content.
we'll put it on OnlyFans. Late Night Legends
oh,
OnlyFans.
Yeah. I mean, technically you can.
HR. Man, HR has never been so involved in the show except for like this last week somehow.
Joan, we need to get you a button that when you press it, it makes that sound.
Well, oh. You mean sound effects? You mean I should have a sound effect?
You should have
effect?
A red buzzer.
Should I have a sound? Which one? Ooh, there's more. Oh, there's certain ones I cannot use. Hold on.
It's Danny DeVito ooh. Just going, bullshit.
I want that so bad.
No, I want
that
one.
One. Hey, do you know what we're talking about with Danny DeVito saying bullshit in the art gallery or no?
I think so, yeah.
Occasionally I'm going derivative.
This I
never
love.
Mind. For some reason, they won't play for me. I do have sound effects over here, and some of them I cannot hit on purpose.
Boo.
But I was looking for air horns because Frank loves air horns. He loves them.
That's sarcasm. I actually hate air horns. I cannot stand them.
Oh, man.
We can't be friends anymore? What?
No. There was just... where I live, there was this very famous DJ around the city who we nicknamed DJ Airhorn, because everywhere he showed up, that was all he would spam. Every song had it, and the transition into the next one was followed by three... and then he would go on, and he would do it like 100 more times before his set was
That was
over.
His thing. I had a friend that went to a, yeah, I had a friend that went to DJ Khaled concert, which I don't even know that guy's music, but apparently he just puts on whatever song and then he just shouts DJ Khaled like
yeah.
the whole time. He just keeps doing that
the
over.
Meme.
Oh, is that a meme? He just did that for
That's
2 hours.
Meme. DJ Khaled. Yeah, we at least my husband and I scream it at each other all the time.
I hope Frank's wedding is 3 hours of air.
You know what? I invited Lord Cronus, and I swear to God, if he goes up to
another
that DJ,
one.
If, I,
another
if
one.
I hear a single air horn at that wedding, I'm going to fucking lose it.
It's going to be the middle of y'all's first dance.
Oh, no.
It will not be in the middle of the first dance. I will make sure of that.
Thank you, Joan. Thank you. Thank you for
but
that.
But maybe if Frank gets up to make a speech, I can't stop people.
If you play an air horn...
I'm not playing an air
After
horn.
After my speech.
I'm not playing an air horn.
They're going to...
I have to travel.
They're going
to
play the chicken dance, and in between the verses, it's air horns.
We actually are doing chicken dance.
Everybody
we are actually doing chicken dance.
People either do the chicken dance or the Cupid shuffle.
No, nah, we're doing chicken dance. Shuffle. All chicken dance all day. That's actually a requirement for my wedding.
I am a little annoyed because Frank's lovely bride-to-be is from a culture that has specific dances for certain songs.
Really?
And one of them is September. And I've learned the dance to this song because I've been to another wedding of this culture. And Frank told me they're specifically not going to play it.
Jughead.
Yeah, that's true. And I'll tell you why. We're not playing that song because somebody who's not attending the wedding got proposed to in September and they play that song. So we're not playing that. We might. I don't think we would.
Yeah, I know, Paige, you ain't talking about that. You better be talking about the comics and not the Riverdale thing. I fell off with that.
Papa Frog is asking me about a dollar dance. I don't know about any dollar dance that I could talk about on this show.
It depends. A dollar dance is when the bride, like, you pay the bride like a dollar to do a short like time of dancing with her, and it's an extra way for the couple to get money. Yeah.
Okay.
It's in different cultures. Different cultures do it differently. Some of the cultures have that, like, the bride just dances around and, like, you hand her, like, the couple gets handed money while they're dancing. Another is that, like gentlemen offer to pay, like, a dollar to dance with the bride for a short amount of time.
Oh, yeah. Kay, what was your money-making pyramid scheme during your wedding?
We actually didn't have one. I missed out on all this stuff.
That people bring extra dollar bills in certain cultures for this. It's not a monkey money-making scheme.
I've never heard of that.
Well, you know what? Maybe you'll hear about that and more on our April 22nd episode about wedding superstitions, because I might add in some fun traditions in there.
Oh,
as
like jumping
well.
The broom. Papa Frog said,
like
not
jumping
lap
the broom.
Dance.
I didn't think of that, Papa Frog. My brain doesn't always go there.
not a lap dance.
I actually would like to share my screen really quick because I have. I used an AI prompt for Danny DeVito doing a Zoom call in four different spooky outfits. So, I would like to show you what AI came up with. Hold on.
My God.
Am I scared?
Here we go.
Oh, come on.
What are we going to see?
It doesn't. It wants.
Yeah, it won't let me do things either right now. I think it's done with us.
It doesn't want me to.
AI. AI's after you now. It's like you've crossed the line. You've gone way too far.
I think if I do this, it may work. No? No, that did not work. I'm
sorry. Whoa, that's all of us.
I'm going to put it in the Discord, and then you guys can all see it in the Discord. I'm going to put it right now.
So, while you're doing that, let's move on to final thoughts. Kay, would you like to start, and I will go next, and we'll have Stormfrog go, and then we'll let Frank round it out.
Sure. My final thought is when I was looking at the painting of the Rain Woman, I thought she would make a nice couple with Big Ed.
Valid. Very valid.
Yeah. My final thought is that you put spirit or life into what you decide to put it into. So be careful with that.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
You're next, Mr. Frog.
My final thoughts are, as the old saying goes, to create is divine. I very much believe that being able to create things, to make stuff, just on a whim, just because you want to, definitely takes a part of you, who you are, your essence, your energy, whatever you want to call it, and it holds on to it and it preserves it. And even years and years and years after you have turned to bones and then turned to ash, you still live on through these things that have withstood the tests of time. And in that way, there is life within it.
I don't know how I'm going to top that. I don't know. I guess I'll say things that are unrelated because I think that really encapsulated sort of some of the parallels I wanted to touch on. So I will say this. I'm sorry that I couldn't log in and I was late today. I got to figure out why I wasn't able to log in earlier. I also would like to say happy April Fool's Day. I would also like to say a big actual thank you to all of our audience, whether it's listening, whether it's viewing, on any of the platforms that we publish on. Huge thank you. You know, we don't do this to get famous. We're just doing this for fun. and it means the world to us that we've had so many people subscribe and like our content and comment on our content. And I think that's going to be a big motivator for us to continue to do this in the future. And, you know, I just really appreciate everyone who's liked it. Like I said, commented, if you shared it with a friend. I know I always say thanks for, you know, telling a friend. I feel like a lot of people have actually done that, whether it's personally or on the internet. I know that we've popped up here and there around Reddit a little bit. And yeah, I just really appreciate the community that we're building. If you'd like to be part of a more direct community, feel free to join both our spooky Discord, which we have a link to in the comments. If you're watching this, it's down below. And also check out the Stormpie community, which is equally as awesome. We've got a lot of people from that particular community tuning in tonight. Shout out to Bree, shout out to Hein, shout out to Paige, shout out to Bean, shout out to Weddo, who is Papa Frog, shout out to Justin, shout out to Lord Cronus, shout out to Alex Jones. Everyone,
no, take that one back. We're not shouting out to him.
Shout out to the person who goes by Alex Jones, who's actually not Alex Jones at all. shout out to everyone who participated tonight and everybody who will in the future. We do this for you, and we hope you have a wonderful night. We look forward to talking to you next week, where we're gonna have Jesse's topic. Yes.
Yep.
Wonderful. We'll see you then. And if you do have any comments about this particular topic, make sure to let us know. We'd love to read your comments on the show if they're really good. If you have thoughts on any of what we discussed tonight, let us know. And if we're missing any paranormal art or things like that that you'd like to bring to our attention, you could always put it in the Discord. Or you could always leave it, a link to it. We'll definitely check it out and discuss it amongst ourselves. And if it's awesome, you know, we might even feature it on a future show. But have all a good night. You stay creepy. You stay spooky. Good night, Paige. Good night, Hein. Thank you so much. And we'll see you again next time.
Good night, everybody.
And Joan, you got to hit the... You gotta-